No one has ever successfully explained to me that plot.
Nanomachines.
This week on Backward Compatible, Jim, Doc, and Chris discuss burnout and churn and their effects on the gaming industry. Plus, first impressions of Metal Gear Solid 5 and who the crew would cast in hypothetical video game movies. The BackwardCompatible.com podcast starts right now.
Compatible.
Hello, Backward Compatible listeners, and welcome to episode number 43 of the BackwardCompatible.com podcast. As always, I'm Chris, and I'm joined today by Jim.
Hey.
And we're joined by Doc.
Hey, everybody.
And today we have a meaty topic that I will let one of you guys introduce, because you seem to have a better grasp of it than I do. Doc?
Oh, well, this came about from a discussion that Jim and I were having about burnout, churn, and whether or not having
In the game industry.
In the well,
we're not talking about like butter. You know, the dairy industry has its own problems with churning and burnout.
Right. No. Basically, what we're really talking about is deadlines. Do deadlines help games?
And in addition, the constant hiring and firing process and how that can potentially harm games in the long term. Devs constantly being brought in for a project and then let go. But that's our meaty topic for later.
And so we will get to that a little bit later, but for now I think we'll go in and open with our usual button mosh.
Get ready for the button mosh, where the crew jumps in on the video games they've been rocking lately.
Yeah, so I've been playing Metal Gear Solid 5. And yes, I'm going to do the entire segment like this.
Where did Chris go?
Don't worry about it. Metal Gear Solid 5, The Phantom Pain, just came out the other day, and have not played very much, but so far it's pretty awesome. Open world game. It's got base building elements, a lot like Peace Walker, so if you liked Peace Walker, you'll probably like this one too. This is not my best snake impression ever, but I'll roll with it.
You did a snake impression and roll with
so,
it.
So what is, like, in terms of, I mean, I assume the gameplay is very, very similar to Ground Zeroes, essentially running the same engine, right?
Right, it's run with the Fox engine, and the same gameplay modifications and refinements that appeared in Ground Zeroes carry on into this new one.
Okay, cool. Because, yeah, I'm going to pick it up this weekend. I haven't gotten it yet, but I am looking forward to it. Are you enjoying it so far?
I haven't been able to play it too much, but I've gotten through a few missions, and so far, graphics are really awesome. The story is interesting. There's a very long, very Kojima-esque intro sequence where you're not... It's very on rails compared to the rest of the game. So you definitely would have wanted to play Ground Zeroes first. Otherwise, you would have walked into this one thinking, is it just going to be like this the whole time? It almost feels a bit like PT, in that it's very sort of horrific in a lot of ways. Very
PT?
Silent Hill trailer, playable trailer.
I never saw that. But you're just saying it has a long intro. That's a lot of it is cutscenes slash mostly on rails. How long is that intro sequence?
I'd say about 30 minutes to an hour. I'm not sure exactly.
I mean, but that's pretty much makes sense for what they're trying to do. Mm-hmm. The kind of epic storytelling they try to go for.
Exactly.
And
it is very interesting. It's very intense. Mm. Not for the faint of heart.
But, I mean, Ground Zeroes is basically the prologue, so you do have to kind of play Ground Zeroes really to go in.
It helps. It helps.
All right, well, thanks for joining us, Snake. Here's to you.
Kept you waiting, huh?
There you go.
Thanks for joining us, Snake. Can we call you Solid?
No.
Well, all right.
On the battlefield, you have no name.
See, interesting little bit of trivia. When Kojima was naming, you know, Snake with Solid Snake, some people made jokes about, you know, what exactly that referred to. Mm-hmm. And then when he... In Metal Gear Solid 2, when they had, you know, the enemy Solidus Snake. Originally, the name was Solid Deuce Snake.
Mm. Oh, I see.
Yeah. Long time for a really bad joke.
Okay.
But yeah,
that was a poop joke.
Snake has left the building, but he asked me to tell you that I will be playing more Phantom Pain in the coming weeks and reporting back on my findings. Mm. But so far, really, really impressed. I'm liking it quite a bit.
Cool. Well, Doc, what have you been playing?
Well, not much, I'll grant you, because the semester has started up. And I'm back in school, which is kind of crazy. But I have been looking at some of the PS Plus downloads for the month, and the first one on the list is Twisted Metal. Now, this is the recent Twisted Metal. This is the one from about 2 years ago. It's a pretty faithful adaptation, and actually, I sort of dragged Chris into a PvP battle before the show so that he could have some comments, too. I have favorable things to say about it, because I used to play it back in the day on my Dreamcast, I think it was, and liked it. It was very faithful and enjoyed it. Although I have to admit, I did actually change the control scheme to racing scheme as opposed to the classic scheme. What were your thoughts, Chris?
So, excuse me. I gotta recover.
He's all choked up.
It was just so twisted.
Oh.
Yeah, I knew what Twisted Metal was. I hadn't really played much of it when I was younger. So when they made the reboot, I was aware of what Twisted Metal was generally. And so my first impression upon seeing the menus, and especially when we started playing, is that the game is definitely made for people who played the original.
Yeah, for sure.
It's like, I think the phrase I used to, I forget exactly what it was, but something like, it suffers, and suffers might be a harsh term, but it suffers from nostalgia, I think, a little bit too much. It's trying to cater to its kind of classic audience. So, like, they call it the classic control scheme, and that's the default control scheme, which, if you play the original, I'm sure you'd love it, because it's just, like, you know, picking it up. I think, Doc, you said that you were able to just sort of muscle memory.
You know, I was.
Pick it up and start playing.
And it's been a really long time.
Whereas for me, I found myself wanting to hit, like, you know, right trigger to accelerate, left trigger to break, and I was just firing my left and right weapons. And so, like, the control scheme works, and I'm not saying it's a bad thing, but having no prior experience with it, no explanations of the controls, like what the controls were, and maybe there's a tutorial I didn't play, I don't know. The menus, when you're setting up the deathmatch, I remember there are all sorts of different settings for, like, fine-tuning exactly, like, what you want the interface to do and all these different things, and it's like, I don't know what half of these things are, I don't really care, you know, you kind of just, like, want to have the game be curated, you know, instead of, I mean, I understand giving the players all the possible options, but you can tell that when it's that prominent for you to be able to customize all those options, it's clearly made for, like, old-school, like, LAN party split-screen sort of gameplay. So, my impressions were that it seems cool, I like the concept, it seems like a fun game, but it definitely seems very nostalgic and not extremely approachable as a result.
Makes sense. Yeah, you know, it's been a long time since I played a driving shooting game, but jumping back into it, it made me want to do it some more.
Get back in the GTA, you can drive and shoot in there too. I'll throw everything to GTA.
Yeah, except this one, you definitely don't want to get into it for the plot. The cutscenes, yeah. Very skippable.
Yeah.
I didn't know it had cutscenes.
Your motivation in story mode is basically want to win this competition so you can get the location of someone you tried to kill but couldn't. You're basically this insane clown who goes on killing sprees. And so the whole opening cutscene is him, like, recalling this evening where it was, like, the one who got away, that he was going to kill her, but that she actually injured him and got away, and so now he wants to go and kill her finally. So that's your motivation.
Would you say it's sort of like the little stories that you get when you're playing a fighting game?
Yeah, I was actually thinking that exactly. That, like,
it's like
felt
this little snippet.
Like,
of
for
story.
Some reason, there's this big tournament put on by this giant, like, corporation or something like that.
Yeah,
where
yeah.
Everyone, like, all the best people from around the world are entering this, like, life or death tournament in order to get this thing. It's
and
very
they all
Street
have
Fighter,
surprisingly
very
unique
dead or alive.
Reasons
yeah.
for being there.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
Because that's how it is always in 2D fighting games.
Yeah.
They all, I mean,
yeah.
or 3D fighting games.
You're so. Not wrong.
And, like, even, like, Soul Calibur, which doesn't have that story, it's very similar. It's that everyone's after the shards of, you know, Soul Edge or Soul Calibur.
But they all have slightly different reasons, too, for being
oh, yeah,
and
sure.
different backstories
and,
as well.
And actually, I mean, like, I really liked, especially when I was younger and I first got introduced to Soul Calibur, I really enjoyed reading up on the characters and their backstories. I actually
yeah.
found it to be, like, fairly deep for a fighting game, even though it doesn't actually come through in the game itself.
The so. Ones that I liked, story-wise, at least as I got older, because it didn't come out until I was older, it was Guilty Gear. I really, like, got into some of the weird, because the storylines for behind some of those characters were just crazy.
Yeah, I've heard a little bit about Guilty Gear. It seemed interesting.
It's fun. It's got really good artwork. Anyway, okay, so I have not played Guilty Gear recently. I did play a little bit more of Sleeping Dogs, and the main reason I want to bring it up again is because of the relationship quest, which I found kind of interesting, in the sense that very quickly I apparently got into a relationship and then cheated in that relationship without even knowing that I was in one in the first place. All because I'm just going to markers to complete quests. So the game doesn't really do a very good job of explaining to you that you're dating a girl or that you're... It does these scenes where... let's see the best example. It's like you go and you help... You show this girl how to hack into a like security camera. And that's how you impress her.
Mm.
And then, and you're cheating because you have like a super Hong Kong police hacking device too. Mm-hmm. So,
that is.
but you don't tell her you have it. So you're like, you're already kind of little shady. And then she's like, how'd you do that? Oh,
it's cheating,
magic.
Not cheating. Yeah. I'm with you.
But then, so then you go back to the, you go back to her like store for electronics and you're going to show her a camera. And there's like a slight innuendo with like the camera, but you're literally going into a camera shop and then it's like fade to black. And now you're like, you know, it's like you're back in your bedroom or something and you're done. Like, she's not there or anything.
Mm.
So you're just, I was supposed to infer from this scene. I found out after looking it up on the internet that apparently right after this scene, like you, at some point had sex with her and now you were now dating. And so now if you go to do any sort of date related scene or help anyone out, like this, the girls that you meet will also like call you. So they'll say like, hey, I need a favor, help me out. And then that will just lead to them dating you. And then you don't even know. Like, so one girl, she's like, I have a favor, come help me out. And the favor was like, she had a gun and I had to stash the gun. Apparently this is a romantic moment.
Mm.
So I got to tell you that I like the story in this game. There's a lot of like brutal, like very Hong Kong action-y type story elements. But the way they do relationships is really quite absurd. Mm. And I just kind of wanted to, I don't know if, I know y'all haven't played this game, but do you have any thoughts on this sort of presentation?
Yeah, so we were talking about this a little bit before we got started, and I think the thing I mentioned is like the whole idea that you go and you basically form a relationship with someone just by doing a mission.
Yeah,
is a little bit odd, and so like you feel like at some point there ought to be like some sort of dialogue option that says like you indicate your intentions one way or the other.
Yeah,
because otherwise it's like. In one way, it's interesting because more games, I think, ought to have this thing where these side missions that we just take for granted as extra gameplay do have narrative consequences. I think that that should definitely happen, but it needs to be done in a way where you actually understand that your gameplay actions have narrative consequences.
Right.
Or you need to differentiate the system by saying, okay, this is the gameplay and this is the romance system,
mm-hmm.
you know, so that you're very aware as the player of what's actually going on.
Well, it's like, I felt like with the cheating quest that triggered, it's like, I guess it was meant to be as like a punishment for, oh yeah, you were cheating around. But
mm-hmm.
if I didn't know I was doing that, then mm-hmm. how can I really be punished for it? I was just confused. I had no idea what was going on. I thought it was going to be some sort of like trick where she was cheating on me, but it wasn't really. She was actually working for like one of the other triad bosses, or she was also an undercover cop, and she thought I was actually a real triad.
Mm.
I thought it was going to be some really clever thing with the story,
mm.
and no, it was just literally she knew that I was cheating on her, but I didn't know I was doing I didn't know I was in a relationship with her either. By the way, I had no idea. So
exactly
I just like
how I met my high school girlfriend.
So I was confused about this entire thing about why I even cared that she was like cheating on me. I didn't even know we were going out. So it was very weird. I mean, it led to some really cool scenes and cool things that you can do.
Mm-hmm.
It was fun walking up to the guy when you actually do confront her, mm-hmm. actually with the guy, like, you know, they're in the street kissing, and you come up and like he says something or she says something to about you being a triad, and the guy's like, "Whoa, I don't want any of this," and just like immediately runs off. So that was kind of funny, but. It was so strange. It was like such a weird way that it presented
mm-hmm.
relationships in this game. And I think a big part of that was in part a problem of censorship,
mm-hmm.
but also because, I mean, they censored so much, you literally didn't know what was going on.
You can be like even a little bit more obvious about what's happening without actually showing
right,
anything.
Exactly.
So.
But not, and yeah, you don't have to go the full BioWare route where it just gets absurd.
Yeah.
but the other thing was the,
are you referring to the dialogue trees?
I was referring to the actual like the like sex scenes that are just
the,
really
the
awkward.
Fully armored sex, yes.
the awkward sex scenes in Bioware games, but also
it doesn't offend me nearly as much as the dialogue
as
trees.
The dialogue.
Yeah.
Well, I was going to say that you should still have some sort of dialogue choices though. Like it
mm-hmm.
should be you should understand what you're doing. It shouldn't just be you accept this mission. Now all of a sudden at the end of this mission
mm-hmm.
you're now with this girl.
Even if you're going with like the very sort of like. Gamerish assumption that like you're interacting with a female as the single male character in order to date said female. Like even if you're kind of going with that assumption, there's still usually that moment of like, do you want to date YN? you know, because like even visual novels have that sort of thing. Like there's like the four female characters and yes, they're all dateable. And yes, you pick the one that you want at the beginning. And then you know, it's all ridiculous, of course.
Look,
but
my character's a badass. Yeah. Obviously, all these women are going to go after him. It makes perfect sense. Course, he's practically like running the city, getting close to it at this point.
But,
so
yeah, but at the same
it makes
time,
sense,
it's like,
but you still have to have that choice at some point.
Well,
right?
even if it's not a choice, even if they just start assuming they're dating you, it needs to be obvious.
That,
like,
yes,
it, at the time and not afterward. Yeah.
Congratulations, you're now dating with a progress meter.
Yeah, exactly.
there's a wedding ring on one end, broken heart on the other.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, I don't really have an opinion, but all this talk is making me want some hot coffee.
nice reference. Of the whole split, by the way, between the relationship and the gameplay, a game that does it well, it doesn't really focus on romance, it focuses on friendship, but Persona 4.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
It really has this very strict split between what you do to further relationships or, like, bonds, I forget what they call them, between the characters,
yeah,
which you want with all of them.
Mm-hmm.
And
you don't have enough time in the year to get all of them, of course, but...
Right, but you want to, like, have as close of a bond as you can because it strengthens you in combat, in the actual gameplay itself, and then the very different gameplay. It also has that split with just, you know, your school life and your chores and all that, and the actual dungeon crawling. So it does a really good job
of it. An interesting tie-in in that, like, it's fairly indirect, but the stronger the bond, like, the better the personas you can craft in that school,
right,
basically.
Right, yes.
And there is a romance element, but it's something that comes from... Like, when the bond reaches a certain point, there's kind of, again, that decision moment where you basically decide if you want to start a relationship.
And they're very clear about it,
yeah.
Which I'd appreciate.
And they're also very clear with, like, if someone else, like, clearly wants to go out with you, it's saying, hey, you're already in a relationship with so-and-so, do you want to start a new relationship, yes or no?
Yeah.
And so it's warning you, hey, you're about to cheat. So it's not quite the same as Sleeping Dogs, it sounds like.
Yeah.
So now we understand, though, the meaning of the title.
Yeah.
So thank you, Jim, for enlightening us.
Yeah. He's a dog.
Sleeping dog.
Should have been sleeping pigs.
Oh, you are a policeman. No. I'm sorry, we love you, police officers.
Oh,
oh Chris.
Except for those
what
Hong Kong.
What did you do?
Except for those Hong Kong police done? Officers. We don't like them. I'm kidding.
Thank you for your service to our community.
To our Hong Kong community?
Yes.
Oh, okay. we're actually recording this in Hong Kong. Live in Hong Kong.
Live from Hong Kong. We should have made a bigger deal about that.
Yeah, we should have actually.
That explains the time.
We should have let off on that one.
Now it's time for Table Talk. Discussions on tabletop games of all kinds.
How to describe Touch of Evil? It's like a B movie. No, that's being too kind. A C movie. Is that a thing? Reference to
would that be like straight to DVD sort of film?
Yeah,
I think it's usually the type of film that MST3K would reference.
It's a board game. Let's start. There actually was a Misty. They did Touch of Evil, but it has nothing to do with that movie.
Yeah.
It actually has to do with the Headless Horseman type of mystique. It's like 10 years after these
Revolutionary War, New England. Yeah,
yeah. You've got the covered bridge. You've got there's like three or four different enemies that you can have. We fought these spectral horsemen. Mm. The spectral.
In the art was very clearly headless.
Yes, but
it's a cooperative game.
It is.
One plays the bad guy. Or
you can. We did not play that option. We actually played it versus. But there is a cooperative option, which is pretty cool that the rule set is robust enough to be able to handle that.
To answer your question a little more directly, Jim, no, you don't play as the villain. The mode that we were playing is competitive co-op.
Right.
So we're all working together to defeat the nemesis, but we're all also competing to get basically the most win points.
Exactly. The way that it works is you get investigation points. They're your money, your commodity. And then you you gear up. And whenever you think you're powerful enough, you confront. You have to figure out where he is, and then you can confront the baddie. They're like hellhounds, and there are ghosts, and there are all kinds of things. You can get as cinematic with it as you want. You can almost kind of role play it like we did. You come in with a character just like any other, say, Mansions of Madness or anything like that. But what I really liked about the game, the thing that I enjoyed most about it was sort of the flavor is very consistent, and it interlocks very, very well. This partly has to do with the fact that it's from Flying Frog. Is that the name of it?
I think it might be. I'm forgetting.
And one of the signature things that company does is they take pictures, they take photos. Mm-hmm. And so they'll actually get people off the street, off the convenience store, to come in to the shoot and to actually dress up, do some LARPing, that kind of a thing. And
like the box art actually made me think LARP immediately.
Yeah, it really did.
It's all photographs.
And they've been criticized for it, but honestly, I think it's kind of cool.
It's charming.
It is charming. That's a good way to say it. Because every card and all of the art throughout has that same look and feel of a modern photograph of this old-timey kind of Revolutionary War look. And so the characters are consistent. And every so often we were pulling cards and we were saying, hey, that's actually my character on there. Mm-hmm. So they're identifiable enough to actually feel sort of viscerally cool. Mm-hmm.
It also comes with the soundtrack.
It does, as do all of their games.
Yep.
But I recommend checking out, if you're into zombies, checking out their zombie series.
Is that one Last Night on Earth?
Last Night on Earth. They're very, very good. I've played that one before. I really like the board on that one because it is modular. Mm. It has kind of L-shaped corners around a central square, and all you have to do is flip over one of the tiles, and you've got a completely new scenario each time.
Oh, cool. Yeah, but I know this one's got an expansion to, like, basically there's one path that goes off the edge of the board, and it can go to basically another board if you got the expansion.
So. But it's not quite the same. But it makes sense because it's a well designed board. You know, it's meant to be kind of loopy. It's like a double figure eight essentially, and there's meant to be bottlenecks, and it's all built into it.
A town hub in the middle.
Town hub, yeah. And you go to the blacksmith, and you gear up, and you do all the other things. But there's so also an alien one.
It definitely has kind of like a traditional RPG sort of cycle going for
it,
where you go out, you do some adventuring, you return to town, you recoup, and then you go out again and slowly move closer and closer to solution. So,
and as the setting goes, it was quite enjoyable. Mm-hmm. So, as long as you read the rules and make sure that you've done the mechanics correctly, it's a quite a fun little game. It takes about 90 minutes to play.
This is the Gaming Meta. News and commentary about the games industry and gamer culture.
So, first of all, I've been hearing about this, so I'm going to call these unconfirmed reports because I've been trying to get more information about it. Unsuccessfully, but there were a lot of people on Twitter complaining about the share button on Metal Gear Solid 5, Phantom Pain, that apparently it's blocking them from doing any sort of streaming of the cutscenes. And some of them were getting got some messages back that they couldn't stream until October, which seems to be a measure from Konami to avoid spoilers. Mm-hmm. And possibly, from what I've heard also, another reason could be that they're worried that it might cause people to not buy the game. They'll just watch the game.
Is that because it's so cinematic?
I don't know. That's kind of what I wanted to talk about.
You see, I could see that applying for the older Metal Gear Solids less than this one, because this one, each of the missions is actually very open-ended. And you can approach the resolution to the mission a whole bunch of different ways. So I think actually this game,
like one of the other ones too.
Even more so with this one though. Like, okay. like if you could have said before with the old ones that like sometimes the appeal is just the cinematics, this one's got a lot less cinematics and a lot more.
Even with one, you'd say that?
I mean, it depends.
Because I'm thinking like if you're like, well, you can only approach it in one way. I mean, you can only approach, say, Super Mario Bros. Or maybe like one different path sometimes where you can go up into the sky and you're on the cloud and you're collecting coins. Mm-hmm. But for
I mean, of course, there are always like ways. For instance, you could always choose like, do I want to just kill or stun? You know, that whole thing. So there are choices and there are different ways you can do things. But this one, I think, even more so because you can sometimes approach a camp from any given direction, or you can choose to like go in guns blazing and go really hard and fast, or you can choose to sneak in very slowly, which of course is a choice you have in other MGSs as well. But it feels a lot more freeing than it ever has.
The levels are bigger, right?
Yeah.
So I think that's kind of what you're referring to.
It's an open world.
Yeah. So you don't have the same sort of like you're trying to get through this one room, clear this one room.
I mean, sometimes you are. Like they have missions in mind where sometimes you have to like go into a particular building to take someone out. And at that point, like, you go into the building and it's, you know, they can plan it because you know they're going to be going in this way and that whole thing. But in the overworld, it's actually quite open.
Okay. Well, I just thought it was an interesting thing, and I had trouble confirming that it is going on because for that same reason, people were finding ways to stream that wasn't with the share button and never really confirmed that they couldn't with the share button, whereas other people were having all these problems.
Yeah. Well, do you guys use the share button?
No.
No, I don't.
Yeah.
I don't think it's just a generational thing. I don't really have any interest. I've never had any interest in the share button. When it's announced, I didn't care. And I think we talked about it on here before.
Yeah.
I
think I was intrigued when they announced it, because I figured that if I ever did want to get into doing like live streams of games, it made it a lot easier. I didn't have to have all the equipment, but I don't know. I always feel like if I'm going to be doing that, I want to be more prepared and more presented.
Yeah.
And not so just like flying by the seat of my pants playing it for the first time, because it's just going to be like, hey, feel free to tune in and watch me fumble around. So, I mean.
Or playing without pants, like some streamers do.
Yeah, there you go.
Well, it just feels to me like a Me Too button.
Mm. Yeah.
And if it was, I don't know, tied into your Twitch account or something, that would be kind of cool.
Oh, that it is.
Is it?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's how it works.
See, I didn't even know that. That's ridiculous that I didn't know that.
I'm sure some people like using it. It's just not for me. But then again, I wouldn't, like I said, I wouldn't be watching this anyway, even if someone was streaming it.
Yeah.
The only time I ever watch gameplay footage is if it's a game that I'm actually stuck on and I feel like I don't know where to find something, and I find a video that shows you where to find it. So
I've done that. I'm not opposed to it. I prefer it on YouTube.
Okay, well, so we have another gaming meta story. So, again, comes from Twitter. So there was a claim by a Twitter account, which I'm not going to name, that said that Samus Aran is transsexual. And this, of course...
He is?
Yeah, this, of course, we know is not true, because there's... as part of her backstory, she was raised as a little girl by the
Samus is a girl?
Yeah.
I'm just totally
that was
right now.
That's a spoiler. Come on. Some people may not have played Metroid before.
That's right.
I've got 100% completion on Metroid before.
Yes, there you go. No, but I mean, this is the thing that, you know, she's been a female character since the beginning. It's never been in contention.
Yeah, that was the big reveal at the end of the first game.
Right. And then later on, they've expanded her backstory with her childhood. So there's really no reason to believe that she's transsexual.
Mm-hmm.
But unfortunately... There were some people that jumped on and were like, yeah, she is, or whatever. Mm-hmm. But then of course, whenever someone comes, people came on and started saying, well, no, that's not really true because, you know, blah, blah, blah. Immediate backlash. And it kind of goes into this, like, fan theory, fan shipping happens a lot in anime, for example, where you in your head, you pair off two characters even though there's not really any real evidence that they're romantically involved. Anyone that tries to tell you otherwise is somehow, like, hating on you or I don't understand why Samus, they're thinking that Samus, it was something like some person that worked on a game at some point made some suggestion that she could have been, which obviously the person didn't know, that's impossible. But I think it's kind of ridiculous because, yes, Samus is a tall and muscular woman, or very fit woman at least.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't mean that she used to be a guy.
It's we have tall and muscular women in real life.
Right.
That doesn't mean they're all trans. So, I mean,
right, exactly.
Yeah, I mean,
I thought it was very strange.
It's like, it's one of those things where people react to, they sort of take it to a place where it doesn't need to go, where just because we're trying to, like, correct a fact, it's like, hey, it's kind of a known thing that this is the case, doesn't mean that we're inherently against transgendered people. Mm. You know, and like sometimes people, like if you argue with them at all, they take it completely the wrong way.
Because,
not just in this issue,
because
all of it,
yeah, no, but. it's some people, it's their opinions become like almost like it's their identity.
Mm.
So therefore, when you argue against their opinions, you're arguing against them as a person. Mm. So it like deeply offends them, and they freak out.
Which is why you never talk about religion and politics with anyone.
Yeah,
except you do, and then.
Right,
things
right,
happen.
Right.
So,
I mean, you shouldn't. This shouldn't be your religion or your politics about, you know, the sexuality or the gender of
a video game character,
a fictional character.
I mean, if you're looking for transgender video game characters, there are some out there.
Right.
Just take a look at Birdo.
Yeah,
that's even Birdo. Nintendo. So.
We were talking before. Bridget from Guilty Gear is one of the more well known. But anyway, yeah, I do want to throw in the comment that Nintendo has softened the features of Samus over time.
Mm.
The original version of Samus, if you remember, especially in Super Metroid, she looked very muscled. Like, she was kind of, like, very clearly fit and thin.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of the modern art of Samus, she's a lot more feminine, mm-hmm. I guess you could say. She's still very tall, but yeah. She's a lot more feminine.
She's gotten a lot more Barbie doll.
Yeah, yeah. I wouldn't go that far because, you know, she still is athletic. You can tell she's athletic. Barbie doll looks like she couldn't even stand up in reality. But
hey,
she's
have you
definitely
seen Power
like
Suit
curvy.
Barbie? She looks pretty
Power Suit Barbie.
Power Suit Barbie. Oh, you're talking about the business suit Power Suit. I thought you were talking about like an exosuit. That actually be kind of awesome.
Exosuit Barbie is what I was referring to, but your knowledge of Barbie impresses me there, Chris.
No, I was, never mind.
Nothing wrong with having that collection, though. whatever floats your boat, dude.
No, actually, I've been seeing stories recently about how like there's either a new line of dolls or a new line of like outfits or something that's like power suits.
That are
business
power suits?
It's a term for business suits, basically.
I know, I hate that term so much. Because I can't, I don't know if maybe I still need to grow up, but I cannot not picture an actual power suit when someone
right.
says that.
Yeah.
It's the first thing that pops into my head, and then I always am let down when I have that realization.
It's
oh,
like, oh, they're talking
suit.
About, yeah, business formal.
Space Marine Barbie, that's
yeah.
Space Marine Barbie.
Yeah.
The aliens licensed Barbie. So.
Yeah, exactly.
This is Roleplay for Roleplay. The mechanics of tabletop role-playing games.
Alright, so in the past we've talked about role-playing games within tabletop, but you know, we have enough role-playing games, tabletop role-playing games to talk about. We decided to do its own segment. So I'd like to introduce to you Roleplay for Roleplay.
Now for the record, is this which one is R-O-L-L and which one is R-O-L-E?
Yes.
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 Okay.
Well, a long-standing concept, shall we say, in this study of role-playing games, which is a thing, I used to teach a class on it, mm-hmm. you used to help me, mm-hmm. Is the idea that there's a difference between ROLL play and ROLE play.
Mm-hmm.
And one is about the mechanics and the other is about the story. And for us, the holy grail of that has always been to find those which minimize the mechanics and emphasize the story mm-hmm. without loss, shall we say.
Right.
So one that we've been really impressed with recently is Atomic Robo, mm-hmm. which is, of course, why we used that system slightly...
Based on the Fate system, right?
Yeah. Which is, of course, open, and as long as you cite your you know, core Fate, it's like a copy and paste thing that you can do.
And that's why I brought it up. I didn't want to get sued.
Yeah, well, there you go.
it's Creative Commons.
It really is. And so it's very open. There have been quite a few of them that we've looked at. Chronica Fuedalis has that attribution, and there are a few others. But what I want to talk about today is Atomic Robo, which is, of course, based on the... Is it a comic?
It's a comic, yeah.
It's a comic series, yeah.
Comic series, okay.
Published by IDW.
I'm not familiar with the IP or the, you know, the series itself, but I know that Will Parsons is a huge fan, and that's one of the reasons why we pulled him in to do mm-hmm. the system and also to do our most, well, I guess current mm-hmm. is the right
yeah.
way to say it, Roll With It season.
And I was going to also throw in, just to name drop, the guy behind Atomic Robo, Brian Clevenger, I believe is his name.
Yeah.
Is that correct?
Right.
And he did the, what's the Final Fantasy, like, 8-bit, what was it called? 8-bit Theater.
8-bit
Theater. 8-bit
Theater, yeah,
which is, like,
the
Final
the
Fantasy 1 comic that ran, like, web comic series.
No, I was a fan of that. That was brilliant.
I was, too, and I remember reading that years and years ago. So it ran for a long time.
I think Brian's actually retweeted us a few times. So thanks, Brian. We appreciate it.
Yeah, for
actually,
sure.
Actually, yeah, he has. It's awesome.
So you know, we had a lot of fun whenever we recorded the River of Time, which is our season 2 of Roll With It.
Mm-hmm.
But one of the cool things about what we were able to do there is we used I should be saying that our GM, Will Parsons, brought in a time travel mechanic and temporal resistance, or resilience, I think it was, temporal resilience,
yeah, right.
Into that system. And we used it pretty pure.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't make modifications to it like we do sometimes
mm-hmm.
With some of our Roll With Its. But in this case, it was perfect because of that pulpy action scientist kind of
atmosphere. Mm-hmm. Well, as it turns out, we were using pre-generated characters, and so even though we were all familiar with the system, we had never actually created characters before. Mm-hmm. And as it turns out, Chris and I had the opportunity to create characters last week for kind of a one-off thing that we were doing elsewhere. And what I was really impressed with personally about the creation process, the character creation process, was that whenever I was done, I knew that my character would evolve and change and grow, but also if a new character were to come in, let's say 30 sessions down the line, right? We had this year-long campaign or something. That player would actually be able to enter right in and would not be terribly underleveled. There wouldn't be any, you know, grindy kind of mechanics or false XP that needed to happen. Your character changes and evolves, but they're still fundamentally humans, action scientists, if you will, setting.
So a lot of the improvements, it's like horizontal advancement instead of vertical.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Actually, that's exactly right. Mm. What were your impressions, Chris?
One, I thought it was very... They had a lot of good ways to do sort of quick creation if you wanted to.
That's true.
Which is really nice. They had a lot of sort of pre-made skill sets and stuff like that. So if you want, you can just sort of take these and be done. They said that if you wanted to, you can do what's called weird modes.
I like character creation.
Which is when you start doing... It's basically like their term, I guess, for custom. If you want to make a custom character with your own specifications...
But weird sounds so much cooler.
There's a lot more math in that one. Like, nothing too crazy. It's still fairly straightforward. But there's more math as far as, like, this many points will buy you this, this many points will buy you that.
Mm-hmm.
And even, like, they had some sort of pre-made weird modes. Modes being kind of, like, aspects of your character, if you will.
Be a robot, be a mutant.
Yeah, be a robot, be a mutant, be a dinosaur.
Wait, be a dinosaur?
Yeah.
Can you be a robot, mutant, dinosaur?
Yes, you can.
I suppose you could, technically.
That sounds like an 80s cartoon series, doesn't it? Saturday mornings?
You know, you could do... we were talking about that, actually. You could do Saturday morning cartoon pretty easily with this system.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it would work really well.
That's actually something we could maybe return to at a later date, is try to do like a Saturday morning cartoon style. Mm-hmm.
Well, I got to tell you, though, I would be very tempted to pull out my old copy of Cartoon Action Hour, though, which is actually, I mean, it goes all the way down to the public service announcement at the end, and then you get extra XP at the end for doing it well.
Knowing is half the battle.
And you always say something pithy, or and it's whoever does that the best. But when it comes down to Atomic Robo, I think that it is an absolutely beautiful system for doing the kinds of stories that we did with River of Time.
Right.
Highly encourage everybody to go check it out. It's a beautiful book. Mm. And
it's got great artwork.
Oh, my goodness.
Because I did look over the
book. It's amazing. Yeah, it's
they actually explained the rules partially through comic strips.
Yes.
Yes.
Awesome. And it's full color. It's one that's worth having on the shelf.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Will was saying that those all of the strips that they have in there are actually directly from the comic.
They are.
Sometimes they change
the wording,
the actual dialogue to fit what they're trying to teach you. So I thought that was a neat touch.
Mm-hmm.
Because I didn't realize that until he told me that.
Yeah. That's something the Evil Hat's always done that I've liked. They did it with the Dresden Files RPG, for example, where they'll actually have sort of in-universe explanations of... what's going on in the game. So yeah, really, really cool book.
Overall. And that was a Fate system as well.
Yep, it was. It was actually before Fate Core.
It was, yeah.
Believe it or not, we're not always playing games. Every now and then, we like to talk about the other stuff.
I'm going to talk a little bit about an anime series that I just finished watching. It's actually a series of short films or OVAs known as Gundam Unicorn. It's like the most recent in the Universal Century, the main Gundam timeline.
So it's not high fantasy Gundam?
No. Okay. It's like real war. They all have fantasy elements in them, actually, but like, because they all have the which is what I'm going to talk about.
Oh, is this the Transformers and My Little Pony crossover I've been hearing about?
No, it's not.
Oh.
It's usually a pretty dark, and this story was actually quite dark as well, like a dark story about warfare in the future where people pilot giant robots. However, there are these people in space that have developed these sort of like, they're kind of like almost like Jedi, like kind of powers sort of thing. It's like, Gundam has been referred to as Japan's Star Wars, especially the original series. So the idea is that some of them in space have been influenced by, you know, space travel or whatever, and they are known as new types, which most people like that aren't new types just think that means, oh, they're just ace pilots, and they are ace pilots, but it's also supposed to mean that they're able to connect and commune with other people, especially other new types, on a deeper spiritual level. So they kind of have this like sixth sense and deeper understanding of other people's motivations and how to connect with people and that kind of thing.
The new types is kind of like a common thing in Gundam, but I think they change up kind of like what exactly they are from series to series, or at least era to era, I guess.
It does for the series that are not Universal Century. They don't necessarily call them new types. They'll have some other thing that they'll call them, or it'll be related a related concept, but they're not necessarily the same thing. But in Universal Century, they're all supposed to be the same because it's supposed to be the same story, even though it takes place over years and years and years.
Right.
And I don't want to get too much into the plot of Gundam Unicorn. It's very much tied into the original Gundam series because it takes place shortly after Char's counterattack, which is sort of the last battle between Amuro and Char, the two main protagonist and villain in the series.
So this one would be Jedi then? Return of the Empire Strikes Back, Char's counterattack. This one's Return of the Jedi.
No, actually, the whole original the original Mobile Suit Gundam series MSG, monosodium glutamate.
Yeah. No,
sorry.
Tasty.
Tasty. So the original series actually was, they made it into a film series as well, into three movies. So that was kind of their Star Wars, Empire, and Return of the Jedi. And then Char's Counterattack is like if they had one more, like, final showdown, because, like, Vader was actually still alive, and Luke had to go out and fight, and also he goes crazy and tries to drop the Death Star on planet Earth and destroy it, that kind of thing. Nice. It was a colony, not Death Star, but... So, yeah, it's kind of a... But he's doing it for a good reason, so there's always this, like, you know...
Destroying Earth for a good reason.
Right, exactly. This one doesn't actually have Char in it at all. Okay. And Amuro's not in it, because both Char and Amuro died at the end of Char's counterattack. Spoilers, a movie that came out in like the late 80s. So, but anyway, the reason I wanted to bring up Gundam Unicorn is not to talk about specific plot elements or how much I enjoyed a lot of the, you know, soundtrack and some of the action. But to talk about this theme that kind of runs through a lot of anime, including some of the Gundam series like this one. It's like sort of the reluctant hero or reluctant fighter, I guess you could say, reluctant combatant. A lot of times the new types are young, because I guess they develop their new type abilities when they're young, I guess. And they are sort of thrust into war because they have this, you know, great talent for warfare, for piloting.
Very Evangelion.
Right. Well, Evangelion is very strongly based, heavily based on Gundam.
Sure.
But yes, that's another good example. What was his name? Shinji?
I think so, yeah.
But anyway... But yeah, another good example of a reluctant warrior, where he has to go out and kill, but he doesn't want to kill, and he tries not to kill, but then somehow, inevitably, he ends up having to at some point.
He's somehow the best at it, even though he hates doing it.
Right.
Yeah.
Because he's special in some way.
Right.
And so I wanted to talk about that in sort of the vein of games, because in games, there are certainly games where in cutscenes they try to put a spin on the character to sort of, I guess they feel it gives them more depth to not just be this... random killing machine. I know it sounds to say that about, say, a character like Mario or Link sounds weird because they're killing like non-human creatures. They're like monstrous things. They're not really meant to, you're not really thinking of them as having like a soul. Like, you know, when Mario's stomping on a Goomba, you're not thinking the Goomba's got a family. But, but you know, he's doing like, regardless of whether he is or not, he's killing something and you're not really thinking about why he's doing it. There's no reluctance on his part. But nowadays, a lot of games, of course, it's because we have more story now. We have this concept of, you know, the hero, maybe they don't want to kill, maybe they have to do it because they have to accomplish some sort of goal. Tomb Raider was an example you brought up when we started, the new Tomb Raider, where it kind of has this, at least at the start, this, you know, this part of the story in the cutscenes. She is sort of thrust into the situation. She doesn't want to kill anyone. She's disgusted by it initially. But at the same time, in the gameplay, that never carries through. And that theme kind of gets dropped because in the gameplay, there's this huge disconnect between how you're reacting and how you have to, you know, you're just trying to accomplish your mission.
Right.
Whereas in the cutscenes, you're supposed to be apprehensive about it. So the difficulty in making this work, gameplay-wise, what do you think?
Well, I think it comes down to the fact that it's interactive, and if your character is reluctant, your player is almost never going to be. You have an enthusiastic gamer who wants to be competitive and to carry out their objective.
But could you make the player care enough about the characters in that world that they don't want to kill them. Like, the character seems so real that they're like, whoa, I don't actually want to.
I think you could.
And they'd go to great lengths, possibly, to fight in such a way that they disarm or disable the person but don't kill them, which is what a lot of the Gundam pilots
do. I don't think you can make the player do anything.
Oh, yeah, not make them. But I mean encourage them to.
You could certainly write it in such a way that it was clear that that was meant to be a difficult decision. I would maybe throw to, like...
It's more like specific, like, a villain or, like, the villain might be a little bit more sympathetic and you might have more qualms about that.
Yeah,
but just, like, day-to-day minions, not so much. Although I will say probably the closest thing I've seen, and going back again to Metal Gear Solid, in MGS5, and you can do this in Peace Walker and to a certain extent in a couple of the previous games, you can actually recruit troops, and you actually recruit them to knocking them out and basically returning them to your base using the Fulton recovery system.
So you have an incentive to keep them alive, so you can actually use them to your advantage.
So it even goes beyond, like, you know, how the system always would give you more points for no kills and that sort of stuff. Or the game.
Which is meta.
It's meta. But now there's actually...
Metal. It's pronounced Metal Gear Solid.
Meta Gear Solid.
Meta Gear Solid. It is actually a pretty meta series.
It is. It really is.
But, actually, that's at the core of the reason I don't like that series. But we'll put a pin in it.
And what's interesting, too, is when you get them to your base, especially now in 5, even more so than in Peace Walker, they get there and they all have a face, and they all are given a code name. Just like, you know, there's Solid Snake, there's also, like, I think, like, Silent Mastodon, which is a pretty metal name. Like, stuff like that.
Silent Mastodon?
I would buy that album. Like that. Yeah, I would totally buy that.
I would completely buy that album.
So, there's a whole bunch of different guys with different names, but, like, there's an example even where there's a bit of a tonal shift, even early on in the game. I'm sure it's going to become more pronounced later. But you start off the game with, like, Big Boss is established over and over again that he doesn't like killing people if he can't, or if he doesn't have to. And so, it basically, like, in character, he encourages the no-kill route. And then you're basically told that you've been in this coma for 9 years and you're just coming back, and they've been taking on all these, like, these jobs that they might not have wanted to take, but they had to. And so it's like, hey, we've got a mission for you. It's just wet work. Sorry, we have to do it. And so you're basically being told, sorry, boss, you have to kill this guy.
No, wet work, for those that may not know, that's like scuba diving.
Yes, it's scuba diving with a bullet into people's brains. Okay. Yes.
I'm being facetious, but in case people listening may not
have
heard that term.
Assassination, that sort of thing. And so you're sent to assassinate this guy, but you can actually choose, because they even say, like, it would be a waste to just kill this guy. Like, we could really use someone with his skills. And they say that several times, and they say it's like, you know, maybe you can find some way to not have to kill him. And basically that translates to just knock him out, send him back to your base, and he actually joins your team instead of you having to assassinate him.
So it gives you a choice. And that is sort of close to what I'm talking about in a way. I mean, obviously I wouldn't necessarily say, I definitely wouldn't say that any version of Snake is the kind of person that shies away from killing. He'll do it if he feels like it's something that he needs to do. But at the same time, in this, what you're talking about is, at least he doesn't take any joy from killing.
Now, are we talking mind wipes here? Is that what we're really talking about?
Maybe.
I mean, is it that you're going to, like, wipe my brain and reinstall software and start fresh, and then suddenly I'm loyal to you?
No. It's more like these are troops. The concept is, because you can't literally do that to every single character in the game. It's like these are troops that, like, they've also been hired. A lot of them are, like, mercenary soldiers too. So the idea is that they don't mind working for you, assuming that they're going to get whatever sort of, like, pay compensation benefits that you
and
are giving
this,
your
in
own
in this case,
for.
Most of them are Soviet soldiers, and so the ones who they say, like, oh, they've been very cooperative, they've always dreamed of living a free life and that sort of stuff, so... Or, like, living like they do in the West, for example, is what they, like, say in character. So.
Yeah, because that's how it works.
Well, that's a very common
thing. But some people actually are resistant, and when they are resisting, you just put them in your brig instead of...
That's how it worked in Peace Walker, I remember. So this and also Portable Ops, same sort of thing. And that sort of idea, I know it seems very weird. This is so off topic, but I read Romance of the Three Kingdoms a while back. It's like this Chinese story about the Warring States period. Was translated. It's from, like, you know.
I think there's some games based on that, actually.
Tons of them. Yeah, all the Dynasty Warriors games. But anyway, it's a super, super old book. Very, very famous. Kind of like an old history. It matches history with, like, legend. A lot of it is exaggerated, of course. But these events did happen. But there's constantly generals will switch sides. Generals and, soldiers that are of, great renown constantly are switching sides because, for one reason or another, someone convinces them to come to their side or they get captured and it's like, okay, now I'll work for you, that kind of thing. It's, very, very fluid. And there's a lot more of, there's a lot less, I don't know if you'd say it's they're not necessarily loyal, a lot of them just aren't, but it's also it's also an element of you've defeated me, so it's I kind of owe you, or that kind of thing. It's this honorable warrior type mentality, and that's always when, ever since Mortal Ops, when Metal Gear Solid started doing that, it always reminded me of that concept. Anyway, yeah, so that's a good example. I do think it's difficult to do it in the way of these, reluctant heroes like in Gundam or Shinji from Evangelion, where they just literally don't want to kill people because they're they care about life. It's one of those things where it's hard to for the gamer to really care because they aren't actual people, especially, it's fictional, and we understand that. We're just trying to win the game. So it's a very different mentality.
Icebreaker.
We have an icebreaker, even though our ice has been pretty well broken by this point. But we have a little fun. Something that I was talking about doing and kind of wanted to do at some point. We're going to cast some video games with modern actors. So if they made these movies, we're not saying they're making these movies. Maybe we are, but we're not going to officially, definitively say these movies are in production. Hollywood, feel free to steal these casting choices and these ideas. They're all going to be gold. So we've got three games listed here, and let's just go on and just kind of go across the table and cast who we think would fit.
Excellent.
Let's start off with Bioshock. It's the game you suggest, the doc. Let's cast some of the characters. Not too many characters. There's Andrew Ryan. I do not remember the main character's name.
Well, the main character is,
I don't know,
a silent avatar, first person. So I mean, you really
did they ever give him a name? Because I don't remember.
He doesn't have a voice. No, I mean,
okay,
that's kind of the point, actually.
Okay. I think he has grunts.
Yeah,
but
now he definitely has he definitely emotes to the sense that he has a voice, but he doesn't talk.
Well, you've got the "Would you kindly" moment where you realize that you're basically a programmed being,
right,
if you will. But there are elements of the second one I think that are very strong as well, where you realize you're the first Big Daddy.
Yeah,
That I think could be included as well. So
we need to cast a Big Daddy.
Yeah.
We need to cast someone to be the Big Daddy. We need to cast maybe a little sister and then just repeat it. I don't know. We'll consider that. But we definitely have to cast Andrew Ryan. We have to cast, what was his name? The other guy. That had all the...
Well, Atlas.
Atlas.
Right? Yeah. Yes. But they turned out to be the same guy, so... Mm-hmm.
But...
Spoilers!
But visually speaking, I mean, do they have to be? Do we have to have...
Well, no. But he was already dead by that point.
That's true.
Allegedly.
That's true, but you still have to have someone do the voice and appear in any sort of pictures and that kind of thing.
Well, that's a good point, I suppose.
He's still a character, even though chronologically speaking, he's already dead. He's still a character in the story. And then for the main character, how do we handle that? How would you...
Liam Neeson.
Well, but how would you set... but, I mean, how would you set that movie up, in terms... Because I don't think Liam Neeson would sign on for a movie where he doesn't even... have a speaking line.
Well, there's a reason they abandoned this movie, actually.
Or should we give him a speaking line? Or are you saying we should give him lines?
I forget Atlas's accent. Was it, Scottish or Irish or something?
I think it was Irish, wasn't it?
No, he was...
am I crazy?
He was, New York... because this was basically the 60s. But he was New Englander.
Oh, okay. Maybe I'm just misremembering.
So he liked his clam chowder? Yeah. Clam chowder?
Well, that was Atlas, actually.
Oh.
He was a working man, sounded like this.
Oh, yeah, that's right, something like that.
And then later on it was...
So Liam Neeson could be Alice. There
a man chooses, right? That was Ryan.
That could be Liam Neeson.
Yeah, well, yeah, I guess so.
Sean Bean? He dies in every movie he's in, so I mean...
Yeah. We need someone with gravitas for Andrew Ryan that can really pull off that, over-the-top kind of, he's a man with a dream kind of mentality.
Hugh Jackson?
Hugh
Jackman?
Oh, so you're saying we need someone who can deliver a really good monologue.
Hugh Jackman?
Yes.
So, Christopher Walken?
Christopher Walken.
that could work.
Christopher Walken for Andrew Ryan. Could you...
A man.
A man.
Chooses.
I was going to cast Christopher Walken as the Big Daddy, but personally.
Oh, that
we have to cast a Big Daddy. Actually, yeah. Vin Diesel would be my pick, I guess, because he can always play Rock. Those.
Well, except the Big Daddies don't have any dialogue, do they? I mean, they could in the movie, they could.
Yeah, they do. They go plong, plong, plong on the wall. What's next on the list, Jim?
This one's basically that's why this movie was shelved, because there's just no way you can cast that.
And the thing about it too, and again going back to the meta comment we had earlier, is that this is a very meta game.
Yeah.
Like the fact that you're the programmed being, it's basically just a commentary on you as a player, just do whatever you're told to do in the game.
Right.
You know, so
mm-hmm. They can have a moment at the end where like it's like, would you kindly buy a ticket to this movie? Yeah. You already did, huh? Directed by Matt Shyamalan.
Would you kindly return your trash to the nearest trash receptacle?
Yeah, there you go. All right, so the next one we got on our list, Legend of Zelda. So we talked about this a bit before, and the running joke being it's just impossible to cast Link. Mm-hmm. Any suggestions on this?
Yeah, actually,
serious suggestions?
Serious suggestion. Okay. Skandar Keynes. This is the guy who played Edmund in the very recent Narnia series. Mm. He's got the look. He's got the right look.
Really?
That said, for Zelda, Dakota Fanning. Wouldn't even have to put elf ears on her. She's got like the pointy ear thing going already.
I don't even know what she looks like now.
Dakota Fanning?
What has she been in? Because you say Dakota Fanning, I'm thinking of like her in one of
War of the Worlds.
Yeah,
when
honestly,
she was a little girl.
Right. That's because I haven't. Has she acted anything as an adult? Because I assume she's an adult at this point.
Yeah,
she's got to be like 20
all,
or something.
She's all grown up. Well, she was born in '94, so
yeah.
Let me hit the old IMDb and see what she's been in recently. In production is Please Stand By, American Pastoral, Brimstone, and Vienna and the Phantoms. You know how these things go in IMDb. You're like, what? What's that?
Yeah.
This is the I was in a movie so I could pay the rent movie. But she was in absolutely nothing. Gee.
Well, she's definitely primed and ready for a new picture. Legend of Zelda, here we go.
Oh, Twilight Saga, Breaking Dawn, Part 2. I don't feel bad about not knowing
absolutely
that.
Absolutely nothing. Like you said, absolutely nothing.
Yeah. So yeah, she was in the Twilight Saga. For those who are into that, they would have caught that, and they were screaming it at the at their iPods. So there you go.
And for Ganon.
Hmm.
And we're just saying Legend of Zelda. I guess we're thinking of like a story that merges a bunch of the elements from all of the games.
And same way that each of the games kind of has essentially the same story in a lot of ways.
Well,
each of them have kind of like their own scenario.
Like Link's Awakening is an exception.
My vote is for the pirate-themed one, where he's Ganondorf the Thief and all of that. That was like Wind Waker style, yeah.
But I think
he never really did the pirate thing, though. He was like just frozen in time, underwater.
Well, that's true.
Were you leading up to Johnny Depp as Ganondorf?
Ganondorf. That would be good, though. Mm. You know,
actually, it looked to me whenever I saw Ganondorf, the way that he looked with that, like he was kind of rotund in Wind Waker. I was always thinking he was. I'm doing it. I told you I was not going to remember actors' names. I can see his face. He's like this. I want to say Greek actor. Did you ever watch Hercules Legendary Journeys? He was one of the guys that played Zeus.
Oh, yeah.
He was like a really accomplished actor, and I saw him in a whole bunch of other movies I forgot, but he always reminded me of that guy.
Speaking of guys who played Zeus, Liam Neeson.
there you go. See, that would work.
I don't think Liam Neeson could quite pull off Ganondorf. I could see someone like, I was joking about him earlier, but I could see like Ron Perlman pull it off. Like that sort of like voice.
Oh, Johnny Depp, I think, where's the Triforce gone? It works.
I don't think I could handle Johnny Depp.
No. Well, how about
Johnny Depp is the happy mask salesman, maybe. That'd be interesting.
Oh, God.
Ooh, there you go.
I could see that. Oh, Tingle?
Tingle.
Johnny Depp. Let's be honest. Johnny Depp could actually play Tingle really well.
He could
pull that off.
I kind of want to see the Christopher Walken Tingle.
Oh,
Tingle, no. Tingle, Kulu Limpa. I do a terrible walk-in, by the way.
You were doing such a great walk-in before we started.
walk-in as Ganon?
Yeah.
Anthony Quinn.
Really?
Okay. Yes.
As who?
As Ganondorf.
Oh, okay.
He's too old now. I think he's dead, actually.
having a dead guy.
What was the name of the actor? He was in Game of Thrones, and now he's doing Aquaman.
That guy. What is that guy's name? Jason Momoa.
Oh, okay,
right. That's the guy that's playing Aquaman. Okay, so and he's also in Game of Thrones. Mm. So who'd you want him to play?
Ganondorf? Ganondorf probably, just because he's got kind of the imposing figure. He can be gruff if he needs to.
But so. Does he have? I mean, the voice, the acting talents for it.
I don't know.
I mean, could always dub that out.
I mean, and Zelda, like, no one in particular has a ton of lines necessarily. They might more so for the movie, but usually most of the talking in the games happens just with, you know, NPCs you encounter.
The owl. Who do we cast as the owl?
Christopher Walken, obviously.
Christopher Walken.
Of course.
He has to, because the owl is a big thing. I mean, in Ocarina and Link's Awakening, he's pretty big.
Yep.
Yeah, he's a pretty big character. So yeah, okay. So we're thinking Christopher Walken for the owl.
Would you like to hear that again?
No.
Who?
Okay. So the final game we got up here is Metal Gear Solid, because again, we're still in Metal Gear mode. So we've got we're just gonna assume we're talking about the original Metal Gear Solid, and I'm gonna throw it out there right away. Christopher Walken pick, Psychomantis. He would be perfect as Psychomantis.
Oh, okay. So you like to play Castlevania?
Yeah. But who would we get for? We have to cast Solid Snake, Meryl.
Mm.
Salt. I was getting ahead of myself. Liquid Snake.
Lucas Till.
Lucas Till.
Yeah, he was in the X-Men movies. The newer ones.
Who did he play?
Havoc, I think.
Oh, okay. I know who you're talking about.
Yeah, he's got like the squared jaw.
And you would think him for Snake?
Yeah. Well, for Liquid Snake.
Oh, for Liquid Snake. Yeah, I could see that. Yes, for Solid Snake. Is there no way we can just get David Hayter?
Yeah. David Hayter.
How old? I think he's pretty young, isn't he? I'd just get David Hayter if we could, honestly.
Nick Robinson, the guy from Jurassic World, the kid from the older brother.
Him? Why?
Because I don't know. Because he looks like a dork, and I think that game sucks.
Oh, but Snake is a grizzled.
I know he is
on the battlefield.
Liam Neeson. I will go see it if it's Liam Neeson.
Here's David Hayter.
Yeah. No, he does kind of have the look.
He's 46, which is not bad for the.
Well, yeah, because Solid Snake's like 65 or something.
But he has the aging.
You could bring him
Nanomachines.
No one has ever successfully explained to me that plot.
Nanomachines.
Which
I just said Nanomachines.
Okay. Did they age him or de-age him?
So he's got it's
whatever you want.
It always starts with so he's. See, that's the problem. No one knows.
He was genetically engineered to age quickly because he was meant to be like the perfect clone of Big Boss.
Right.
And so the idea was that if he fell into the wrong hands, he would die before he could be too incredibly useful.
Okay. But he's not old anymore, is he?
He's extremely old in
Metal Gear Solid 4, yeah.
Does he look old?
Oh, yeah.
Big time.
And he's very young, too. Like, his contemporaries. All look like they're just kind of in their late 30s, early 40s, whereas he looks like he's in his like 70s plus.
Okay.
So anyway, but we're getting a little bit off topic here. What about Revolver Ocelot? Is another big character cast in Metal Gear Solid?
Well, he's played by Troy Baker in the in Metal Gear Solid 5, and they actually model his character model a bit after Troy Baker.
Well, Troy Baker could definitely not pull off Revolver Ocelot in a movie in this age.
No.
I don't even know what you're talking about. So.
Now I'll show you why they call me Revolver.
Like I want to say he had to be based on Lee Van Cleef from the old, spaghetti westerns with Clint Eastwood.
Yeah, I was about to say maybe Clint Eastwood. Maybe he's just a tad too old.
Well, no, but he's definitely too old for this. But I think Clint Eastwood maybe a few years ago could have played Old Snake.
Mm-hmm.
But I think it's a little bit beyond that.
Or Old Ocelot even.
Or Old Ocelot, yeah. Mm-hmm. But Lee Van Cleef. Have you guys seen Good, Bad, and the Ugly? I'm sure.
Oh yeah.
So you know who Lee Van Cleef is, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so Revolver Ocelot was very heavily inspired by... He's basically just Lee Van Cleef.
Oh, okay.
So in terms of appearance. However, since we can't, like, just, you know, have Lee Van Cleef play, like, because he's been deceased for years, who could we get to play? Like, I mean, think about that. Use that as your reference point. Someone that could pull off a Lee Van Cleef impression
in 2015. The guy from 24's dad.
Kiefer Sutherland?
Yeah.
But you mean his dad.
Daniel Sutherland.
Hmm.
How old is he? Would he be too? How old is he at this point?
He was in The Hunger Games.
Really?
Yeah.
Who was he?
He was President Snow.
Okay,
that's right.
Maybe he could, because, I mean, like Ocelot is a lot older than Snake in the first Metal Gear Solid, right. So maybe that would work. I didn't think of that. Okay, that's actually probably our best casting choice.
So far, I don't know.
We've not done a bad job.
I think Ocelot would need to be a bit more wiry.
Really?
Yeah, I don't know.
Someone perhaps like Christopher Walken? No, he's already Psycho Mantis. He's nailed on.
No, he just plays like all of the Fox, all of the Fox
all the unit. Parts.
Yeah, he plays all of the villains, basically. Yeah. It's like, so now I'll show you why they call me Revolver.
Christopher Walken. Walken and Christopher Walken.
Yeah, what about, what was his name? Like Vulcan Eagle or something like that?
What was his name?
Barrett from Final Fantasy VII plays Vulcan Eagle.
Yeah.
Or Sniper, no, Sniper's a different one. Sniper Wolf was a different one. Well, we're definitely not casting directors.
Yeah,
because I mean, any movie that they'd call us in to be casting directors, like, all right, who are you going to cast Christopher Walken as this time?
Who's that guy? That one dude's dad.
Would love us though. He'd be like, hey guys.
It's like the director who like a director and an actor have just like a really close relationship in all their work, so they always collaborate on one thing or the other. So, yeah.
All right, so let's move right along to our meaty topic. I think it's time.
It is time.
So a lot of this was spurred by just the discussion that Doc and I were having on, you know, Facebook Messenger. And I had mentioned that I've been hearing a lot of things about this has been going on in the game industry for a while, particularly in the West. It's fairly well known at this point that whenever they're gearing up for a big project, a new game project, they'll hire a whole bunch of people. And then work them really hard. A lot of times they'll hire kids right out of college that are, not just desperate for work, but also looking to, like, really gung-ho about, I want to work in games.
Mm-hmm.
And then by the time the project is over, they're burnt out. They've been kind of worked to death. Mm-hmm. And then
lots of crunch happens.
Yeah. Lots of crunch. And then they typically just get let go, too. A lot of them will get fired just because they no longer can, I guess, maybe they can't afford to keep those many people on, that kind of thing. So there's this huge turnover.
Yeah, you're given a budget for a game, and when that budget runs out, sorry, guys.
Yeah, so there's this huge turnover.
Mm-hmm.
And, I was talking to Doc about how I think this is kind of a poisoning, it's like a poisonous dev cycle. It's sort of really holding games back creatively. Because not only is it really difficult to think creatively when you're really tired and when you're being worked really hard, but also it's the sort of thing where you have to kind of like hone your craft and learn, especially if you're working in like a certain engine or with a certain tool or with a group of people, a small team. There's a lot of things to learn. You have to like learn how to work with those people. You have to learn how to get the most out of them, but you also have to learn your tool. You have to learn the tools that you have available, and you have to learn how to best use them for this sort of project. And that also can help you in terms of innovation and coming up with new ideas and coming up with, you know, a whole bunch of new things. And you can't really do that if you're constantly rolling over new people into it.
Mm-hmm.
So I do feel like that is possibly one of the reasons why we have so many repetitive games, repetitive game concepts. So, Doc, what do you think about
this? Well, I want you to consider it's 2007.
You're time traveling again?
You are. Yeah, there you go. You are making a new game. It's kind of revolutionary in terms of graphics and what you're trying to do with it being open and that kind of a thing. And for 2007, it's pretty good at this. And you're calling it Assassin's Creed.
Oh, I thought it was going to be Sonic the Hedgehog.
And
that was 2006.
Yeah, there you go.
You wouldn't know that.
You've got 100 people.
Hmm.
And then you show your demo reel. And it's beautiful. It's unlike anything anybody's ever seen before. And your budget goes up. And you decide, in order to get it out in time, we're going to double the amount of people on the project.
Mm-hmm.
It works so phenomenally well in the next, let's call it, quarter, that you're able to double your budget again and double your workload again, so that by the end of it, there's 400 names in the credits. Mm. This game is so successful that it spurs an entire franchise where you split the team, double down again, and you have one team working on the sequel 2 and another team working on the sequel of 3, so that by the time 3 actually comes out, you've got that team from 2 working on 4 and so on and so forth,
and
with bunches of spinoffs and all kinds of transmedia.
And one of the other problems that you get into with hiring all these people to work on one game project is you have, like, so many different voices, so many different, like, because there's only so much that you can work on at any one time. So it makes, you end up a lot of times with a less cohesive product.
Mm-hmm.
And you start to move away from the original concept and original idea.
Well, yeah.
And it gets diluted because you've got all these minds in there that are doing things just a little bit differently, even if they're working off of a central idea and, like, you know, storyboards and that kind of stuff.
That's right.
At some point, they're going to get pulled off more and more. And you know, you have creative directors, but how well is he really going to be able to wrangle 400 people?
Right. Well, that's exactly right. And suddenly you've got middle management, and you've got to split the teams, you've got to do all these other things. Let's talk about just one simple aspect of that. The core game mechanics themselves, in other words, the controls. That scenario I just gave you is real. That's basically the way that it happened. And the team that was working on Assassin's Creed 3 had the leisure of knowing that Assassin's Creed 2 was going to come out beforehand. What they did not have was access to the basically the control scheme. And they kind of did their own thing. And so what you've got is a game that came out and was very, very good and improved on the controls of the first game. That would be 2. And then 3 came out and people went, wait, the controls are worse again. They've gotten bad again. What happened? Well, what happened was it's not that they didn't learn from 2 or that they reverse engineered it or anything like that. It's that it diverged from the control scheme of 1 and went a different direction than 2.
And these companies weren't communicating with one another.
And they weren't, right. I mean, they were in different parts of the world. This wasn't a big enough thing. And the argument was, and this is a valid argument, that there was enough of a gameplay difference between the focus of 2 and the focus of 3, which was the America one. You're jumping around in trees, you're doing other things like that, that the remapping of the control scheme actually made sense for what that game was supposed to be. The problem is that it hurt that game. It hurt it a lot. 3 was a weak. It was a weak entry in many, many ways. By the time 4 came back around then, though, which of course was that other team, essentially, I mean, it gets all mixed up and it's hard to say. But if we're speaking in simplest terms, 4 was fantastic because it was about ships. Well, it turns out that ships were actually a mechanic from 3, but it was done poorly in 3. So it gets really convoluted and really confusing, but basically what you have is it is a team that is so big, so large, that I have to question, where is the creative direction actually coming from?
And it's interesting, too, because it's like all those teams were Ubisoft, right?
They were, yeah.
But, of course, Ubisoft has got all sorts of studios, and usually the only distinction you get, if at all, is it says, like, this one was Ubisoft Montreal, this one was Ubisoft Vancouver, or whatever.
Right.
Well, I forget all the locations. But Call of Duty, for example, the more recent Call of Duty games, they basically have 2 main studios on that, and they also have different names, so you can distinguish them a little bit better.
Mm-hmm.
But there's a distinct difference between, like, you know, the Black Ops series versus, whatever else Call of Duty's been putting out.
Yeah, the mainline Call of Duty.
Because, like, basically every other year, kind of, like, the good Call of Duty comes out because it's the one that people, they like that studio style better.
Mm-hmm.
And the same thing kind of happens with Assassin's Creed. We've got different studios working on the same franchise.
Right. Well, and to just as a quick side note, I'm a huge Prince of Persia fan. I loved Prince of Persia 2008. I thought that one was one of the best. That series, that whole franchise, has basically kind of fizzled and died because they chose to go in the Assassin's Creed direction instead, with the historically based instead of the fantasy. When you look at it from a design perspective, they're not that different as games. You've got the free-running aspect, you've got, you know, the fighting aspect, that kind of a thing. And so they didn't really want to compete with themselves, which is one of the reasons why there was no sequel to the Prince of Persia 2008. Now, they did go back and do a mid-sequel to Sands of Time and that kind of thing, and it was okay, but they hadn't invested the same kind of, let's call it, infrastructure into the franchise as they had with Assassin's Creed.
Hmm. I'm not sure about the creative direction specifically. I'm sure they have people in those roles. You're right about just how far that went, like, you know, because I got so diluted. It's not like... to me, it feels like Nintendo tends to have a pretty good job of keeping a creator's vision for a project. I'm not going to say I like every Nintendo game, but I do feel when I'm playing one that there is a creative voice that sort of is coming through, kind of like that. To use a film term, like the auteur concept in film, you kind of feel that in the games.
Yeah, for sure.
And I do think that when you're saying like Assassin's Creed in particular in that series, I don't feel that. I feel there's a lot of voices, you know, a lot of cooks in the kitchen. It doesn't necessarily mean that it produces a bad game, but it also can sometimes lead to a game that's not quite as focused.
Yeah.
But also, I will say, when you were talking about all the people, you know, you have 400 people working on something, and just where is some of that creativity coming from? It kind of reminded me of, you know, Star Wars and Lucas's approach, and so, especially in the earlier ones versus the prequels, where he tried to be a lot more controlling. But this idea of you have all these people inside a room working on, you know, modeling out different aliens and all that kind of stuff, and if you just kind of let them, give them free rein to model it however they feel like, with very loose ideas, you're going to get some really cool concepts, some really cool ideas. And I think a lot of what made the prequels great was he just sort of was more hands off. I mean, not the prequels, the original series great, original trilogy great, was he's a lot more hands off with a lot of these creators, and sort of let them bring their own contributions to it.
Yeah, people were scared to tell him no for the prequels.
Yeah, and then when it came to the prequels, he would just, like I said, there was a story in For Phantom Menace in one of the like behind-the-scenes stuff where he goes into a room with all these people modeling aliens, giving him like different ideas, and he just comes in and just like immediately, it's like, no, that's terrible. Take the nose from that one and take the forehead from this thing and put them together. There you go. Like,
yeah.
That kind of like idea. Mm. Very different sort of mentality from what he had going into the first one. So, in a sense, getting ideas from all over the place is good to a point, because there is a lot of creative input that potentially your team could bring.
That's true.
However, when we are talking about a game studio that has these very tight deadlines that are usually, they're set by sales teams and by, you know, marketing and that kind of thing. They're not really set by the creator. The creator's not saying, for example, Metal Gear Solid 5 has had its own issues with, you know, release dates. Kojima wasn't the one setting the release dates. You know, it's like it's a marketing team in Konami with Assassin's Creed. You know, any of the directors and, you know, creative directors behind that and any of the storytellers, none of them are setting the release dates.
It's well, and you just said something really important. Whenever you said Metal Gear, you named...
Yes, I named the creator, and that's because in Japan, I really do feel a lot of Japanese companies, they try to have that that auteur approach. You know, you've got guys like Miyamoto. Sorry, what's his name?
But we can
Shigeru Miyamoto,
Tezuka, the other.
I'm
thinking of the other. Or is it Takeda? Tezuka's the manga guy from Astro Boy. Sorry,
we could do the same thing for American franchises, though. We were talking about Bioshock.
Oh,
earlier.
Sure, we can.
Bioshock, we immediately think Ken Levine, or at least we should.
Yes, yeah.
Whenever we start talking about Psychonauts, you know, we immediately go to Tim Schafer.
Yeah, we've talked about Sid Meier on this series before.
Well, of course, he brands everything.
True.
Sid Meier's, you know.
Well, he became a marketer. I mean, what was his other name? The other guy, Cliffy B, sort of became that way too. Where it was like he became a spokesman as well as a designer. So like that happens sometimes. Like Sid Meier was like that guy who does he does like they're basically like mostly QTE style and storytelling. Like that guy lost his kid in like the mall and he's calling him out.
Jason.
Yeah.
Oh, you're talking about Heavy Rain.
Yes. What's that guy's name? Gage, isn't it?
It's French, so I don't remember.
Maybe I'm thinking of the wrong name.
Yeah, he's French Canadian.
But anyway, that's
Peter Molyneux might be someone you could argue potentially.
Yeah, I think no, definitely.
No, that's a really good example.
I think that's a good
But that's the point is you name some of these creators and you understand that they are in creative control. And whenever we're talking about Assassin's Creed, who?
Like there's a writer, but I think the writer has since left and stuff like that. Like,
well, but you know, a lot of these games, you go back to a game like Legend of Zelda, and there's writers in the different Zelda games and that kind of thing. But there is the one guy who is the creative director who is like the final concept voice.
Right.
You know, and for the earlier ones, it was Miyamoto. Now it's that Aonuma, I think is how you pronounce him. Aonuma,
yeah.
But you know, Takeda was involved a lot of that in terms of like you know, the storytelling, level design, that kind of thing as well. Mm-hmm. But yeah, you some of those names you know because they're more focused, mm-hmm. smaller teams, or possibly.
Mm-hmm. And Miyamoto is often involved in a lot of projects as a producer, I imagine, just kind of like to have that oversight to sort of say like maybe you can tweak this or change this,
right?
But
yeah, in something like Assassin's Creed, I can't name. And there's certainly a lot of Western developers. And I'm not going to say that it's Japanese developers. There's plenty of them, too, that we don't necessarily know.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'll throw Jade Raymond out there, actually. She was on one of the original teams. She was a producer.
Right, but she wasn't actually the concept. Because I saw a lot of the behind-the-scenes stuff for Assassin's Creed was coming, and she was not the creative director
person.
She was the, and that's who we're trying to name is the creative director. I mean, she had an important role. Producer is one of those like very underrated roles. Mm-hmm. It is extremely crucial to get a.
I think Assassin's Creed began as a multi-person sort of concept. Like it was a writer and maybe one or two designers.
Well,
or
that's
like
the
that.
Disclaimer at the beginning.
Well,
of
we can,
the game
right,
actually.
And we can say that, and that's great. But who are those three?
Multi
like, I don't remember
that's
their
the
names.
Thing, you know,
yeah. Like, at one point I might have been able to tell you at least one or two. Yeah, but.
That's a good point, though. I mean,
but we should know their names. You know, there's a few of them.
Jade Raymond is no Kim Swift, who was the very clear creator of Portal.
Right. Yes. Yeah. So I mean, yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like producer is a different role than creative.
Yeah. That's
I mean, we're looking for just like when Miyamoto some of those games he gets labeled as producer on like tons and tons of games.
Yeah.
Doesn't have really that much input in a lot of those games that he is producer on. It's mm-hmm. I mean, he certainly is given some input, but obviously because he's like a legendary.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Figure.
Well, let's pick on Bioshock just a little bit. I mean, Ken Levine was, with his interviews, he mm-hmm. famously said that he waited till the last minute to write it. But he was supposed to be on too. And the idea that he pitched to them was the little sisters have grown up, and one of them is a big sister now, mm-hmm. and she is the main boss, and you're going to have to fight her at various points in the game, and I'll give you this really cool backstory, and it turns out that some of the other characters will come back, but it's 10 years later, it's going to be awesome. And they did an ARG and everything, I mean, an alternate reality game to spin this thing off. It was great. Until there were some difficulties, it always comes down to money, and he was not on the project. But they kept his idea as the seed. And then they said, okay, how are we going to expand this? And there was nothing. I mean, it was like we don't know where he was going with this because, once again, he's one of those guys who writes at the last minute. So basically they just said, you know what, we'll just make it so that the big sisters are enemies, plural, just like the big daddies were in the first one, go. And created a bunch of new areas. And that's the reason why that plot just kind of drags in the mm-hmm. middle, let's call it three quarters, is because... The writer from the first one was not there. His core idea was there. And the second, the millisecond that you have to fight the second big sister, the droning begins. It's just like, I have to slog through this. And don't get me wrong, I actually enjoyed the DLC much, much better.
Yeah, I agree.
The whole beta story I thought was brilliant.
I still enjoyed... In terms of just playing through the game and the gameplay, I still enjoyed 2 more than Infinite.
Did you really? Just gameplay-wise?
Yeah.
Well, I think...
Infinite annoyed me, I think.
Having... Oh, more than Infinite, you're
that's
right.
That's what I'm talking
oh,
about.
Oh, absolutely.
Not the original. No, Infinite annoyed
me. And to be fair, Levine was back on Infinite.
That's kind of what I'm saying. I mean, because he did a great job on the first one. He also did System Shock 2, which was a very enjoyable game.
Biggest problem I had with Infinite, actually, was I saw the rather lengthy... It was like a 15-minute... trailer, if you will. It was the big trailer. And I was expecting to get to that level, and I never got to that level, because it turns out that was parsed out, and it was actually just a compilation of different scenes.
Yeah.
All the cool stuff from the game was compacted down into 15
minutes. I know
exactly
what you're talking about.
Yeah, and so...
That was obnoxious, and then also the... there was that demo they had really early, where... Elizabeth was much more interactive, and
yes.
they made it like seem like she was this like real, almost living, breathing character, and they had all these cool little moments.
Proper sidekick.
Yeah, and they had all these really neat moments, and I was like, whoa, this is going to be so cool, and then they just cut all of that, because like, it's too hard to do.
Yeah.
So there was that. So both of those elements came into it, and so there was a big disappointment factor.
Yeah, I almost wonder if, like, I know a lot of people who do like Infinite quite a bit, but I almost wonder if their perception was colored by the hype of the initial pitch, the initial trailers, And then when they played the game, it wasn't quite up to expectation, but like they were kind of the impressions from the initial stuff carried through the gameplay experience extent that they were. Like, because a lot of people still praise, like, oh man, Elizabeth was such this great character. I'm sure, like, she was still a cool character or anything like that, but it sounds like she didn't live up to what was
kind of... She wasn't much of a character at all.
No, she was kind of whiny,
yeah,
actually.
She wasn't really much of a character at all. I thought... No, I think... Not to get too deep into Infinite, but I do think that... And I don't want to pick on people that love Infinite per se, but I do think that there's a lot of element of... A game gets hyped up enough, people will start buying into it, and they'll just love it without even really realizing what they're talking about. Because maybe they feel like if they say something against it, that someone will call them out and say, like, how dare you not like that game? Mm-hmm. Justify it, and they can't? I don't know, but...
Yeah. But again, I think that's a case where, had there been a little bit more committee in the writing, instead of, Levine, save us, it might have been a better story, it might have been a better game, it might have made more sense.
How much, you know, how necessarily dedicated was he to the project? Or was it like they brought him in because they were like, oh no, we have no idea what to do, but we want to make another Bioshock game?
Well, that's a great question, actually. I don't know the answer to.
Because, I mean, he was kicking around the concepts for Bioshock for a while, and it built off of what he had done with System Shock 2. It was clearly a labor of love type situation, and I'm not so sure that's the case with Infinite. Mm-hmm. Aside from... some of the concepts of, like, the way the world was set up, like, you know, you're in the air space kind of, like, setting and that whole thing, which I think was really a really cool idea. Aside from that, I didn't really feel like...
Maybe one of those cases where you got really awesome world building, we don't know what the story you want to put into it.
Well, there were really two problems that I saw with Infinite. And the first was there were no strong characters the way that there were in the first Bioshock. You had, you know, Atlas, you had Ryan, you had all these subplots. And as you pick up the data recorders, you get to know these people who are now dead and gone. It was just a really cool experience. And that didn't happen in Infinite. The second problem was there was a revolution story that was going on.
Yeah.
And you turn around, you literally blink into another dimension, and it's already happened.
Mm-hmm.
The coolest thing about that game, because I keep waiting for the revolution
to
break out.
Yeah, I was building up to it, and then it just kind of goes right past you.
Uh-uh. You never actually see the revolution. You don't participate in it. You're told that you participated and were instrumental in it, but you never actually do it.
Yeah.
Hello, video game. Want to do it.
I also thought that it moved away from the, like, horror elements that were in the original and also were in System Shock 2.
Absolutely.
And losing that, I feel like they lost a big, like, kind of a core concept for the series.
Yeah.
Without realizing just how crucial that was to the series.
You lost the shock in Bioshock.
Well, to use an example from film, North by Northwest makes you feel absolutely trapped in a completely wide open field.
Mm-hmm.
They had that opportunity and they failed to do it.
Yeah. But yeah, I do think that you do want to have extra voices in there. You do want to have some collaboration. You want to but what you want to do is you want to find what can I not do and what sort of things can I not come up with myself and what sort of skills and talents and thoughts do I need to add to this project. And surround yourself with those people. And I think when you have a good project, whether it's a game or a movie, that's what happens. Versus, we're going to have these focus groups and these suits decide how many people that we need to meet this deadline. And we're just going to bring in anyone that we can to meet this deadline.
Mm-hmm.
And then we'll just worry about them later when the project is over. Don't worry, we'll just get rid of them.
And when you're doing a sequel, too, there's definitely something to be said for having the team that worked on the first game work on the second game. Because they know it.
No kidding.
Maybe,
it's like
but
when they did...
Well, but hold on. But it depends on the sequel. It depends on what you're doing with the sequel. Like, how closely are you following the previous one?
Sure. I'm just saying...
Because with Zelda, you could potentially, in some of these, they change a lot of the teams up. Aside from Miyamoto for a lot of the earlier ones, they changed a lot of people up.
Well, let's say...
Time's a factor, too.
Yeah. Time definitely is a factor. But, like, you know, say, going back to the Assassin's Creed thing, you know, people will argue that 3 suffered because it didn't have the same team as 2, you know?
It didn't have the same team as 2, but it did have half the same team as 1.
Mm.
And so did 2, which was a superior game by almost all accounts.
But how many? I mean, some of those people were kept, but I'm sure that they got rid of a lot of people between the projects and then brought back in new people.
Well, that's true.
So it might have been, like, similar numbers, but... how many of those were the same people that had worked on the previous one.
And some turnover is natural, of course. I mean, even if they weren't laying off a bunch of people after a project, I'm sure some people are going to leave for other companies or retire or whatever the case might be.
That sort of thing happened, if we want to... I mean, a really good example of this is World of Warcraft. Mm. Because in World of Warcraft, a lot of those people that were working on it initially, they had all gone by the time, you know, you got an expansion into it. And that was one of the reasons why the quality of the game kept going south.
Yeah.
Because all these people that knew it so well and had been working on it for so long, they all left, and they bring in new people. And all these new people are trying to figure out, first of all, I kept hearing a lot of the problems was like they couldn't figure out the code. They didn't want to throw anything out. So like that's why there would constantly be new problems with the game, that kind of thing, because they're trying to maintain, you know, code that's like several years old, but they don't know it very well. But also it's also an issue of like design and concepts and what they're trying to do, what's the driving force in this game. And with each new expansion and each new addition to the game, it felt like it was just veering more and more off course.
Right. Yeah, you ended up with nerfed levels and the ability to get to 60 very quickly.
Mm-hmm.
And then the big enemies actually had, because they had so much HP and they were so, the players were so powerful, you had to do them in waves. Basically, kill him three times because the numbers would be so high that the servers can't handle the math.
Yeah.
Kind of a thing. It was very weird. Weird stuff.
The earlier raids and the earlier dungeons were done so much better. And when I say earlier, I mean the earlier content, not earlier levels.
Right.
Were done much better. There was a lot better focus there, and it just it really lost the plot as it went on.
Well, for those who really miss early WoW 10 years ago, I recommend WildStar. Same team that we were just talking about, largely responsible for WildStar. And it's space, but it's got a lot of sort of sci fantasy, you know, swords and blasters kind of thing. It's a lot of fun, and it just went free to play. So,
oh, cool.
Yeah. In the good way, I would say.
In the good way. Well, a lot of them are anyway.
Yeah.
Starting with that concept.
Yeah, but they're not doing it the right way. Like Star Wars 4 just went free-to-play, and oh, man.
Well, it didn't just go free-to-play. It's been a couple of years now, I think, but...
Well...
Yeah, it's not a good example of how to do free-to-play.
Okay. Yeah, that game's older than I'm thinking it is.
It actually went free-to-play super quick. I think it was, like, about a year, if not quicker.
Yeah. Well, they just did something major recent. What was it? It was a...
It might have been a new expansion.
Okay. It had something to do with
our new patch.
With being able to play all the core stuff.
Mm.
Problem is your gear doesn't level with you.
Mm.
And so it's totally desynchronous. Mm. Our guest Andy was telling me about that.
Oh, okay. I've thought about getting back into the Old Republic because there were some stories I wanted to play through, but every time I would get it reinstalled and start playing, I'd kind of be like, 5 minutes later, I'm not really in the mood anymore.
Yeah.
Partially just because it took so long to get installed.
Well, there you go.
But...
leave it installed next time you feel it.
Yeah. Except then I can't install all the other games that I do want to play.
Oh, so. Of course.
Yeah, I mean, like, I've seen... there have been more and more people now, I think, talking about... like, I think Gama Sutra... I didn't get a chance to actually read the article, but Gama Sutra put out an article about... posted an article about crunch. And does crunch actually help the development process, or does it hurt more than anything? Like, because when it comes down to, like, you know, deadlines aren't necessarily a bad thing. Deadlines, you know, as most creators will probably tell you, a deadline can really be a great motivator. You know, if like you're kind of like languishing away with a concept, and like what am I going to do? You're like constantly refining. A deadline can kind of force you to like get something done.
But that's what benchmarks are for,
right? And it's also got to be to a point. Mm-hmm. And I know,
and they're taken too far, obviously, it's a bad thing.
And also, a lot the problem is that it's not so much that you're crunching for a deadline; it's that the deadlines are not set by the people that know what you can realistically do within that time.
That's a really
They're
good
set
point.
By sales. Yeah. And sales is doing it based on when are we going to make the most money?
Yeah.
What is the market telling us that you know, the market's saying, oh, well, the market wants this game later in this year. Mm-hmm. The market wants this game in 2 years. It'll be ripe for this game if we get it by Christmas in like 2 years.
Yeah.
Go do it, guys. You may not have the team for it. Mm-hmm. And at a certain point, throwing more people at the project doesn't work.
Yeah,
because
it doesn't help.
They, you know, you can hire modelers all day, but you can only really have so many programmers to work on a project. You can't just have, like, you know, 70, 80, 100 programmers, because then you're going to have all this code that doesn't work together. You can only have a small number of certain people. You can only have a small number of, like, people that are actually coming up with a lot of the creative, making the creative choices. You can't have, like, 70, 80 writers. It's like the old, like, monkeys at a keyboard concept. It doesn't work. At a certain point, it doesn't work. You have to have a smaller team. That's one of the reasons why it's the same thing with, like, when television was in its rut with all the sitcoms, because they would bring in, they would write by committee, they would bring in, like, you know, sit around with a team of, like, 20 writers and try to churn out an episode. That doesn't work. Mm. You need to have a creative force behind it.
Mm. Although, writing rooms can be a good exercise in certain contexts. Like, I remember when we were working on our ARG, Dark Dealings.
Yeah.
And granted, it was not a 20-person writing team. It was a 4-person writing team.
Right.
But we sat down and we spent, like, a day brainstorming. Yes. And then when we had to actually write scripts, though, we'd hand it off to one person who'd write the script.
And I think that totally works when we're talking about... Because, like, I don't think that the team concept is bad. I think it's the... When you get to a committee, when the team is so big, it's like a committee. Like,
right.
When you have writers where you've got, like, 2, 3, 4 people, that's okay. But when we're talking about 20 people...
Yeah. Writing by committee is never a good idea. Yeah.
Right.
So, well, you know, that actually reminds me of the E.T. game, the notoriously, quote-unquote, worst video game ever.
Which is really not.
It really isn't.
It had some really cool ideas.
It actually did. And
some terrible ones.
Well, here's the thing. 1982, Atari says, you've got 3 weeks, and one man, Howard Scott Warshaw, in 3 weeks puts this game out.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, a lot of people played it at the time and were like, this is pretty cool. This is neat. He did some things with perspective. He did some things that, you know, pushed it into the third dimension that hadn't been done before.
Yeah.
Really, really amazing takes. It was just really, really hard.
And also very ambitious.
Yeah.
I do think that he had some really cool ideas that just could not be executed with the hardware that he had.
That's right.
And so I would definitely not call it the worst game, because I think if we're talking worst game, we're talking a game that is just, like, all fluff, is not bringing anything new to the table. It is just... And not only that, but it's also, like, very poorly designed, etc. At least... Mm-hmm. You gotta at least give someone, you know, maybe not an A, but... Maybe a B- for effort. You know, you got it. You can't fail them for trying so hard and coming up with new stuff. It just maybe it didn't quite work out the way that it could have worked out. And I'm not saying it's a great game, because it's not.
Yeah,
there's a lot of problems with E.T., but it's not the worst game.
No,
it's not the worst game on the Atari.
It was
either.
It was also badly timed with really the end of the company.
Yeah.
In its form at that time,
they made way, and they of course pushed out way more copies than they could possibly sell.
Which is why they ended up putting a bunch of them in landfill in New Mexico, which they recently found. There's actually a really good documentary on it. It's called Atari: Game Over. It's on Netflix. I recommend it.
And there were other games in there, too. It wasn't just
E.T. There were, actually. And that was kind of neat that urban legend was validated. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, it also vindicated Warshaw in many ways, because of the fact that the other games were in there. And it kind of proved that it was a dumping ground for all their inventory from a warehouse.
Mm-hmm.
They were just throwing a bunch of stuff away to get rid of it. It wasn't a condemnation of the game specifically.
And I think I've always thought that it was more of a Pac-Man issue than a E.T. problem.
Oh, I agree.
Because with Pac-Man, the way that the game was set up on the Atari version, you couldn't see the whole screen.
Mm-hmm.
So it had that, like, had to do that scrolling thing, which essentially just ruined the entire game.
Yeah.
So it doesn't work like the arcade. You can't do that. So when you're trying to have arcade ports and your target base is thinking, I'm going to play these games just like they are at the arcade, and they can't do that.
Right.
Because your conversion is just, your conversions are horrible. That was kind of like a tipping point, because Pac-Man was like the game. It was like Pac-Man and Donkey Kong were the two big, like, we have to get these on the home market games.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't do them. They didn't do them right.
Yeah, this is the problem we have with iPad now. Or I should just say pads. Pad ports. You can go get Bioshock on your pad now.
Really?
Yeah, you can.
I know there's a lot of games that they're putting on you know, iPad and iPhone now. And a big problem with that is that it's the control. Like, control schemes are just completely different.
It's a bad idea.
Yeah.
It's a bad idea. And what it means is there's going to be a generation that grows up that is going to think about that game and go, I don't know why that was so great. Mm-hmm. And they're not going to have had that same experience. But, you know, there's positives and negatives to that. I mean, a lot of the Zeldas that people play and remember, they played them on Game Boy. Whereas, you know, you and I, Jim, played them on our console. And so it's a shared experience that's cross-generational because of that. So there's positives and negatives.
Yeah. You mean like playing either the ports, you mean like the ports on like Game Boy Advance, that kind of thing, or like the DS and 3DS downloads.
Okay. Exactly, anyway, yeah, so if you're thinking of starting a video game company, consider this whenever you make your millions and you have to upsize your team. Maybe you shouldn't. Maybe you should ride the long tail a little bit.
Yeah. Actually, one of my... the guy that I work with at the company, like his whole thing is he likes saying, for bringing people in on projects, he likes to refer to like doctors, nurses, and surgeons.
Mm-hmm.
So he's like, we can only really have a few surgeons. We only can have a few really specialized people.
Mm-hmm.
But we can have like some doctors, but not a lot of doctors, and then we can just have as many nurses as we can to get this project out.
That makes sense.
So it's kind of like I would say, it goes back to, we don't do 3D, but it goes back to the modeling stuff where you can bring in tons and tons of modelers if you want to. If you're like, if they know what they're doing and you've got, you know, good art direction, you can make, you know, sets and characters all day that fit into the right theme and like the textures and all that's going to work. But when it comes into programming, like I was saying, you can only bring in a few programmers.
Yep.
You can only bring in a few, you know, creative minds, and at some point, someone's going to have to be making the final creative decisions. You can't just, every time you have a creative decision to make, you can't just go consult 19 other people. Doesn't work.
That's right.
It's hard enough. It's like go into like that room with the 19 people and like, you're not, hey guys, we're going to order pizza. What do you want on the pizza? It's like kind of concept.
No, we only have three toppings.
Yeah. You're going to get so many different answers. And it's like, well, I can't eat meat. Yeah, you get that one person that's like that. And now all of a sudden you've thrown out like half the toppings that people wanted to order. And it's like, well, I don't like mushrooms. They make me gassy or whatever. I mean, you got like tons of people that just,
I'm dairy free. I can't have cheese.
Yeah. I mean,
why are we ordering pizza?
I can't eat bread. Let's not get the
I'm gluten free. Yeah.
Tomatoes. Oh, sit well with me.
No chicken wings. Well, I guess that about does it.
Yeah, that about does it.
Well, thank you everyone for joining us for episode number 43 of the BackwardCompatible.com podcast. I'm Chris.
I'm Jim.
And I'm Doc.
And we'll see you next time.
We want you to join the discussion on our website, backward-compatible.com. You bring unique perspective, and dialogue makes everyone better. Leave a comment in our podcast section, and if it's good, one of the crew members will respond to it. Developers, tell us about your indie or industry experiences with Burnout or Churn. Thanks for listening. Until next time, stay compatible.
Backward compatible.